According to a report published today, our children and grandchildren are in mortal danger because the nations of the North are too rich and those of the South too poor. Welcome back to our discussion on the Brandt Commission. And joining us now, Sarah Hogg, economics editor of the Economist, Andrew Alexander, political editor of the Daily Mail, and David Lee, assistant general secretary of the TUC.
And also eight graduate students from the Institute of Development Studies. They're from all over the world, north and south, and as future economists, they may or may not, over the next few years, be instrumental in implementing the Brandt proposals. I'd like to start with you, Bashwa Singh, from India. What's your initial reaction to the Brandt report?
Well, I would say that the work of the Brandt Commission takes a very balanced view of the world situation as it obtains right now. I particularly approve of the emphasis that it lays on the mutuality of interests between the countries of North and the countries of South. And for the first time, it brings out the fact that both the governments as well as the people of North as well as South are equally important in shaping the future. Now, but and so far as that is concerned, it goes very well. The major problem that the Commission's work and the recommendations that one faces is that the report sounds to be too good to be true in terms of its implementations. And if the third world governments and the people from the third world countries have any apprehensions, the apprehensions are more on account that in the real bargaining situations, the ones who are already better off, they take the better deal. And it is there that the report doesn't really much say as to how this entire operationalization is going to be done. And I particularly am more concerned on that account with the approach on redistribution of incomes and achieving the stable levels of consumption of the poor state of the society.
Right, so it's basically it's practicality that you're worried about. I'd like to move on to Richard Lloyd and Neurath of West Germany. Richard, the Commission's been called the most important event of the decade. Do you think it is?
I think in some ways it clearly is, because it draws attention to perhaps the most important problem facing the world at the moment. And in that sense, I think it very clearly is. I'm worried about the implementation of it. And the thing I'm worried about relates to technology and the rapid technological progress that we're witnessing at the moment. And the thing that worries me is that we're witnessing a situation where technological progress is throwing people out of work faster than it can absorb it in new products, for example, microchips. So what you get is a fight for jobs, in a way, because there are not enough to go around. And another problem with technological progress is that as you progress technologically, you replace men with machines. And the problem is that machines don't buy anything. So in the end, you're going to have a problem that your ability to produce outstrips the ability of people to buy. So you have a fight for markets. And in a situation where you have fights for jobs and fights for markets, I have doubts as to the mutuality of interest. I think that it turns into a conflict of interest, because you're fighting over limited jobs and limited markets. And my question would be, to what extent do you think that technological progress, in fact, undermines the basis of the proposals of the Brandt Commission?
Ted Heath, will you answer that question?
Yes, I don't believe it does. First of all, on the ordinary trade, the statistical analysis which was done for us showed that, in fact, the balance of jobs between North and South, as a result of the South selling its primary industrial products to the North, and then the North selling capital equipment back, it was in balance. And so the general argument that if we accept textiles and shoes and so on, then we automatically lose jobs is not, in fact, statistically proven. In fact, exactly the reverse. Now, when you come to the new technology, then our problem surely is we haven't got the markets. There are two problems. There is a supply problem and there's a demand problem. And at this moment in the world, there is not the demand. And that's why we've got 18 million unemployed, which will rise to 20 million or more in the OECD countries, and why we've got between $250 and $400 billion worth of empty capacity not used. Therefore, the argument is, as Sunny has also emphasized, that what we need to do is to create the demand in the world and at the same time adjust in our own countries to the supply needs.
Sarah Hogg, you've got some practical objections to the report, though you admire it in its essence.
Yes, the analysis is compelling, and I only hope it compels, because it's a constant uphill task persuading the world where its enlightened self-interest lies. But of course the commissioners don't just offer us description, they're practical men and they offer us solutions. And the main solution is a new world economic institution. Now, apart from a certain inbuilt resistance to committees that propose the creation of other committees, I have one worry about this, which is that we already have two world economic institutions, the International Monetary Fund and the World Bank. And their grasp on authority and resources is very tenuous, but it exists. And I have a worry that a third institution would simply dilute the authority and resources, the muscle, if you like, that these two institutions already possess. Now, of course, this new institution proposed, the World Development Fund, would have its own resources, the commissioners suggest, some form of world taxation. Now, there's nothing that revolutionary in this idea. After all, a few hundred years ago, national taxation seemed revolutionary. But I don't think it's in any way a shortcut or an easy solution to providing more development finance. We have in Europe an institution financed in much the way the commissioners suggest, the EEC. It has a levy on existing taxation. That doesn't stop enormous arguments within the EEC, as we know in Britain, about who provides the money and where it goes.
Organisation, another organisation, does make me...
Well, perhaps I could just explain our line of thinking here, and Sally can correct me if I'm wrong. We started off with the basis that we don't want to see more institutions. Indeed, secondly, we make a recommendation that there should now be a small, high-powered monitoring body under the Secretary-General which will examine the United Nations institutions and cut out the overlapping and the overmanning and so on. Thirdly, our line of thought was that if the existing institutions are not prepared to broaden out in the way we suggest, then you come to a World Development Fund. In actual fact, I think the response from the world institutions is rather more hopeful than we expected. We know that Mr. McNamara has taken the 17 recommendations which affect the World Bank from the report. He's put them to the directorates. He's asked for early responses as to what the World Bank can accept and so on. So it may be that we can deal with that in the way I suggest. Now, there's one other aspect, the fifth, which is that many of the developing countries in the world don't accept the present structure of international organizations because they say they were created by America and Britain who won the war, and they don't take proper account of the position in the world today of the 105 developing countries. Now, this does mean some change inside the World Bank and the IMF in its representation and also in its management arrangements. Are they prepared to do that? If they are, well and good. And then it won't be necessary to have another World Fund. But what we have to recognize is that a large amount of the money is going to come from the OPEC surpluses. And OPEC will only work with an international institution if it has the approval of the rest of the third world as well as the North. And this, I think, is a crucial point. Now, here again, there is some hope because OPEC is now finding that whereas they could have their money recycled commercially through the banks, as you know, the banks are now roughly on the limit of what they are able to do in this respect. So they have surpluses, which is the finance minister of Saudi Arabia told us, and also the finance minister of Kuwait. They literally do not know how to handle those surpluses. And this is the opportunity now, which we have between North and South, to see that they are put to good investment use and at the same time create the demand which the North wants to deal with its technology and its problems.
Andrew Alexander, I know you two gentlemen know this already because you read his piece in the Mail, called you a lot of windbags. We sat on the commission. Now, having heard two of the windbags, using your word, have you got something more to add to that?
Well, the Brandt Commission is 300 pages long. There's no difference between anyone here about the need to alleviate poverty, but the Brandt Commission report is 300 words long, and nothing I've heard today makes me change my mind, and I wonder if I could put, as it were, the opposition case in just about 4 points. The first is I think we should challenge the statistics, including the statistics we heard at the beginning of the programme. They are very misleading. Now, we heard that the average income in India is £60 a head. Now, this is achieved, but this is statistic is arrived at by using some very confusing international exchange rates. Now, the truth of the matter is that if the average income of the average person in income in India was £60 a head, in the sense that we know it, i.e. they receive £60 worth of goods and services a year, they would be dead. That is the simple truth of the matter. Of course, it is the statistic can only be arrived at by the use of artificial exchange rates. It is totally misleading. £60 is not really the income as we would understand it of the average Indian. Now, I think the Brandt Commission also goes wrong in the way that it suggests the reason why some countries are rich and some countries are poor. If you and I were to put two individuals up against each other, perhaps they would be farmers or shopkeepers or craftsmen or whatever, and if one worked very hard and the other didn't, and if one organizes affairs very well and the other didn't, and if one was always looking for ways of being more efficient and the other wasn't, then you would not say that the difference in the subsequent income of those people would be an injustice, which is what the Brandt Commission suggests. It's not injustice. I'll give you perhaps a more tangible example of that. The monetary income in Germany of the average person is nearly twice what it is of that of the average person in Britain. Now, and similarly, it's much higher in the USA than it is in Britain. Now, we don't say that this is the result of an injustice. We know perfectly well why it is. It is because they organize their affairs better, and that is the reason why one country is much richer than the other. And it would be ridiculous for us to say that because Germany is richer, and we know why that is, because they work so hard and arrange their affairs so well, to say that because that country is richer than us, therefore it should transfer part of its income to us is ridiculous. If we want to be as rich as the Germans, we must arrange our affairs in the same way as the Germans. And may I make just two final points? India cropped up in the discussion earlier on. Now, in the case of India, let's take the state of Gujarat, which has got quite advanced agriculture by Indian standards. Now, there are a number of laws in India which militate against good agriculture, one of which is the non-slaughtering of cows. You will never get a decent dairy herd if you refuse to allow the slaughter of cows. And I don't see why British taxpayers, for example, should assist Indian agriculture if it won't take this first step. Also, in the state of Gujarat, the amount of land, irrigated land, which an individual is allowed to, which a family is allowed to earn, is a maximum of 18 acres. Now, we all know if you want efficient agriculture, you want large farms, not small ones. Why should British taxpayers, or any taxpayers in the Western world, have to contribute? Because these necessary institutional changes in the underdeveloped countries are not undertaken. And one final point is that in many parts of Islam these days, there is a strong movement towards preventing women from going out to work. I have to say, why should British housewives have to go out to work to help to pay the bill for aiding Islamic countries where they refuse to let women go out to work?
Well, if I can bring in Bushra Farooqi, because you're from the Indian subcontinent, you heard the picture that Andrew Alexander was painting there. You're from Pakistan, in fact. What did you think of what he was saying?
Well, I think, yes, all very nice, as he was saying. The report is nice in what it says, but there's a very fundamental problem. It assumes that there is a north and there is a south, a united common interest in these, but clearly there isn't, and it was illustrated by the problems of why should, say, labor in one country help labor in another country when you have problems of unemployment in your own country. And right, they're advocating free trade, but what happens when the newly industrializing countries and the developing countries want to compete in the same products and want to get into the same markets as the developed countries? Wouldn't the problems of excess supply be aggravated, in fact? And what I'd like to ask Edward Heath is he planning a very planned restructuring in the developed countries to accommodate the recommendations of free passage of goods, raw materials, etc.?
You want to come in here, though, don't you?
Yes, I think we must really take up Mr. Alexander. I read his piece in the Daily Mail, and I was convinced at the time that he hadn't read the report. I'm reinforced in the thought now that he couldn't have done. He really makes the world sound very simple when he says that all the problems of development, all the problems of disparities can be just swept away on the ground that we're all working with imperfect statistics, the World Bank, the IMF, OECD, everybody else. That the whole problem of development is that the third world is lazy. If only they'll work as hard as the Germans and the Americans, all would be well. I wonder if he's ever seen a worker cutting cane at the height of the sun at midday. And if that's his image of laziness, the problems aren't as easy as that. And we don't solve it by really saying that all the imperfections lie in the south if they'll only get their structures right.
No, I'm saying
and if
that
only women will contribute. No, just let me finish. We really cannot get to the heart of the problems of development in terms of the report. Let us forget other issues. Unless we face up squarely to, I think, what is the challenge of the report? What is in it for the North as well as for the South? Can we envisage a world in which we go on as we do at present, with the disparities growing wider and wider. And if you took only the question of the future of the North without taking account of the lives of people in the South, I think you're bound to come to the conclusion, and Sarah Hogg was good enough to say the arguments are compelling, that of course there won't be progress in the South in a world economy that is characterized by uncertainty and instability and disorder. But nor will prosperity be capable of being sustained in the North if we don't do better than we do at present with reducing those disparities.
What I'd like to do now is to bring in David Lee, because obviously you've talked about, or the Brandt Commission has talked about, a lessening of trade embargoes and restrictions. What I want to know from you is how you're going to sell that to your TUC workers, to the Coventry car worker, for example, who must be very worried that he's going to become unemployed with the vast quantities coming over.
Well, I'll perhaps make three points. The first is that I hope people don't get the impression that Brandt has recommended that there be an absolute cut in our living standards. The relative decline in the share of what's called the North relative to the South is compatible with an absolute growth of living standards as long as the world economy continues to grow to the year 2000. It's a very important point, because I think the so-called zero-sum game, whereby one job for me is one less job for you or vice versa, is an impossible situation to live with, and the world would polarize in that situation. The second point I'd like to make is that there's perhaps an over-tendency in the report, which I perhaps haven't read as fully as I should have done, but nevertheless, the concept of free trade is, to some extent, juxtaposed as against protection. And that's a bit of an oversimplification as the message comes across to people, because what we're looking for in the future is perhaps a third route, the planned growth of trade. There are some areas of trade, about 30% of world trade now, I believe, where there is a degree of planning between North and South in the growth of the trade. And that is compatible with a program of restructuring to protect employment as it's changed in the North. My third point, I think, is to do with trade unions as such. There are trade unions in the North, there are trade unions in the South. I myself go to the United Nations Commission on Transnational Corporations. I represent the ICFTU, which has got unions in the North and unions in the South. And one of the recommendations we hope to see in the UN code, in the implementation of it, is that in the transnational corporations, there should be scope for establishing information and consultation bodies bringing together the representatives of workers in the North and in the South, because if they don't meet, there will be a growth of misunderstanding. But I think there is every grounds for optimism with the concept of mutuality of interest, if we can allow this dialogue to proceed with the workers' representatives brought together.
Do you think, Hassan, and if you could speak on behalf of your own country, Iran, are the implications of the report too impractical as far as you're concerned?
Well, I think that's a very interesting question, but any evaluation of the practicality of the report cannot be done without any regards for the political structures of the world in which we're living. And I was going to add this important dimension to the debate, and Mr. Peter Alexander's remarks, in a way, reinforced my conviction about the importance. I wonder to what extent Mr. Alexander is aware of the fact that the British and the Americans were directly responsible for upkeeping a repressive regime of the deposed Shah in Iran through the CIA-engineered coup of 1953. And from there onwards, which I think there's not much enough argument back Mr. Alexander's point of view, at least in historical terms, I'm afraid I must say may even arise from historical ignorance. I would like to point to the Brandt Commission's recommendations, which in a way abstract from the political reality of these countries, in which the repressive regimes are perpetuating economic policies which in many ways are brought out in the Brandt Commission report. As, for example, for industrialization policies, some of the most repressive regimes in Southeast Asia, like South Korea, Taiwan, have in fact already successfully implemented some of the industrialization policies which the Brandt Commission report has generalized as a recommendation, like the sustained increase in production and exports of manufactured goods. I think this is an important point which the Brandt Commission abstracts away from the political reality of the system in which these economic policies are to be put into practice. And for that, I visualize a certain fundamental restructuring within the South as well as within the North.
Well,
I think one of the things we must face, quite frankly, and the Commission did face it, and commissioners from the South were particularly anxious to face up to it, is that there is a good deal that needs to be done within developing countries in terms of the restructuring of their own societies and the restructuring of their own economies, that equity does need to be established home as well as between countries. I don't think we ought to be arguing about that. Some countries have a better record in the third world than others. I would not myself have thought that there is a necessary correlation between the political system in South Korea and Taiwan and the economic programs that they have pursued. I would have thought it was perfectly possible to have a different mixture, if you like, and that one could take some of the better things out of the economic system and to place it with better things in political arrangements in other countries. So there are many variables, and certainly from a developing country point of view, I think no one should shy away from the obligations that rest on the South. But they are not obligations that are preconditions of action on the part of the North, both in terms of global issues and in terms, I think, of the future self-interest of jobs in the North.
We've got 1 minute left, and I would like to ask you this. Having put forward these ideas, what have you done now to set up something to carry them out, an action?
Well, you see, the Commission came to an end after we'd finished our report, because we are not an administrative body, and therefore the follow-up has to come from outside the Commission. But we are keeping in close touch with governments and with authorities concerned, like the World Bank, like the IMF. And I think now that what we want, certainly in the North, is to get the European Council of heads of government meeting to deal with this and show that they're prepared to talk business. Then I hope it'll be discussed at the meeting of the seven in Venice in June, which brings in the Americans, the Canadians, and the Japanese, and let them say, we're prepared to do business. This, I hope, will bring a response from the major OPEC countries with surpluses, who say, very well, if you're prepared to do business, we will do the same, and then bring in the other developing countries. That's how I want to see it develop.
And I'm afraid that's all we've got time for now. I would like to thank all our guests for coming in today, and I think it would be important for us all to regroup in a year's time to see just how far the Brandt recommendations have been put into practice. Good afternoon.